Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Hath blessed is past tense. I want to look at some of the places this morning at where the things of God are past tense. Now, somebody said these are spiritual blessings, and they somehow rule out healing or things in the physical. But the things that come from God, first of all, do come from the spirit realm. Faith is of the spirit realm. Faith is of the heart. And we overcome, the victory that overcomes the world is our faith. Well, the world is the physical realm. And the victory that overcomes the world is our faith. Jesus said, in the world you'll have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. And Philippians 4:19 says, God supplies all of our need. Well, that's on the in the physical realm. But it's according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Jesus in Matthew 6 said, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things should will be added. The Gentiles seek things. Your heavenly Father knows you have need of all of these things. So he's talking about the physical realm. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, because if you want God involved, then you operate in the things of God, the principles of the kingdom of God, and the righteousness of God that is by faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And then the things of the physical realm come. They come from God and because of the kingdom of God. And so these are spiritual blessings, but the spiritual blessings are applied also in the physical realm. And yet Ephesians 1:3 says it's past tense. Many people are trying to get God to do things that his word has expressed he's already done. Amen. They're trying to get God to do what his word expresses that he's already done. Well, if it's already done, then I need to hear about it, believe it, and then receive it. Instead of asking God to do it, once I realize he's already done it, then I need to receive it and thank him for it. Amen. There's another place where it's past tense in 1 Peter 2:24. Now, this is referring to Isaiah 53. Isaiah 53 is a prophecy looking toward the cross. With his stripes, we are healed. Looking toward the cross, prophetically, that has not happened yet. With his stripes, we are healed in Isaiah 53. But 1 Peter 2:24 puts it in the past tense because now it already has happened. Who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we being dead to sins should live under righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. Were is past tense. So he's already done this. Once I realize what he's done, I need to believe it and receive it instead of asking God to do what his word has expressed he's already done. He's already provided it. Well, he's blessed us, already blessed us with all spiritual blessings. How do I get them here into the natural realm? By his word, believing it in my heart. Faith is the bridge, bringing it from the spirit realm into the natural realm. Jesus said in Mark 11:24, what things soever you desire, when you pray, believe. At that moment, believe. The moment you pray, believe that you receive, and then it'll happen. You'll have it. So I believe it according to the word, and I receive it before I see it, before I feel it. I can say to the Lord, I believe I receive that. And then I thank you for it. Jesus said I'd have it. Well, your word says I'm healed. I thank you for it. I thank you for it. by whose stripes I was healed. If I'm healed, I thank you for it. You've already blessed me with all spiritual blessings. I thank you today for the blessings. I thank you that they've already been provided. I thank you that they're already mine. I thank you. There's something that Jesus said in Luke chapter 5. He is teaching. The power of the Lord is present to heal. But religious people were there scrutinizing him and examining him and criticizing him. And they were saying things in their heart. Well, I sometimes, because I've had this same experience, by revelation, you hear it as if it was said out loud. To you, it's said right out loud. Because he asked them, he said in verse 22, what reason ye in your hearts? He perceived, verse 22 says, he perceived their thoughts. They were criticizing him and scrutinizing him. Well, he's teaching. Verse 17 says he's teaching. And the latter part of that verse 17 says the power of the Lord was present to heal them. Everybody there, the power of the Lord is present to heal. But because they're criticizing him and scrutinizing him and examining him, they weren't receiving him. When he said, especially verse 20, man, thy sins are forgiven thee. Because they saw, everybody saw it. He saw this man let down, verse 19 says, through the tiling with his couch into the midst before Jesus. Verse 18 says he was taken with the palsy. And so this man is coming down through the roof. Jesus said, man, thy sins are forgiven thee. And they began to reason in their hearts. Verse 21, who is this which speaketh blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God alone? To Jesus, it may have been just as if it was said right out loud. Because he perceived their thoughts. I've been there when, to me, it sounded like they said it out loud. Because of the revelation gifts that would operate as the Spirit wills. What reason ye in your hearts? Now look at verse 23. Whether is easier to say thy sins be forgiven thee or to say rise up and walk? But that ye may know that the Son of Man hath power upon earth to forgive sins, he saith unto the sick of the palsy, I say unto thee, arise and take up thy couch and go into thine house. And immediately he rose up before them, took up that whereon he lay, and departed to his own house, glorifying God. And they were all amazed, and they glorified God. Now, Psalm 103 tells us, even in the old covenant, healing was a provision. Forgiveness of sin was a provision in the Old Testament. And yet the Bible teaches that Jesus is the mediator of a better covenant established upon better promises. Well, anything in the old covenant, we've got better because Jesus is the mediator of a better covenant. Well, if it's better, then it needs to have at least as good. How can something be better if it's not at least as good? And then better. Jesus is the mediator of a better covenant established upon better promises. And Psalm 103 says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Now verse 2, bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgiveth all thine iniquities, who healeth all thy diseases, who redeemeth thy life from destruction, who crowneth thee with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfieth thy mouth with good things, so that thy youth is renewed like the eagles. Well, verse 3 says he forgives all our iniquities. One thing that we have better in the new covenant is not only are we forgiven, but we're cleansed. The blood of Jesus washes away our sin, cleanseth us from our iniquity. But in the old covenant, the blood would cover the sin and they were forgiven. We've got better. And then people today, just almost anywhere you'd go, in any church, especially any church that would name the Lord, name the name of Christ, just everywhere, Christians believe this part of the verse. Is there any sin that God won't forgive if you come to him and ask him? Oh, Brother Tony, there's no sin that God won't forgive. When you humble yourself before the Lord, come to him and ask him, God forgives every sin. This says he forgives all of our iniquities. Is there any sin too hard then that he won't forgive? I mean, coming to the Lord and asking for forgiveness. Does he ever say, no, that was too big. That one was just too big. It involved too many people. You hurt people. You hurt other people. You hurt yourself. That's just too big. No, when you come to the Lord and humble yourself before the Lord and ask for forgiveness, is there any sin he won't forgive? And you could go from church to church to church and ask Christians, ask preachers. This verse says he forgives all of our iniquities. Do you believe that? Oh, yes. He forgives all iniquities. Oh, yes. I believe that. Brother Tony, I believe that. He forgives all iniquities. But the next part of the verse says he heals all our diseases. Do you believe that? Do you believe that? And that they'll balk. They're not so quick to answer now. Well, he'll forgive every sin. Yes, I believe he forgives every sin. When you come to him and ask him, he forgives every sin. Well, will he forgive every sickness? Well, now, Brother Tony, you know, he doesn't heal everybody. I know somebody who didn't get healed. That's what they love to say. I know somebody who didn't get healed. Well, I know somebody who didn't get forgiven. They didn't ask him. They didn't come before the Lord and humble themselves and receive forgiveness. But is there ever a sin that when you come to the Lord that he will not forgive? No, they believe that, but they don't believe the other part. They believe he forgives all iniquity, but they don't believe he heals all sickness. They want to give you a rationale. They want to give you their justification. They want to explain it their way. No, I don't believe that. But see, in God's eyes, one is just as easy as the other. It's a provision he's already provided. And if you can receive forgiveness of sin, you can receive healing of your body. One is just as easy as the other. Jesus asked, which is easier? Which one is easier? Can you be forgiven of your sin? Yes, then you can be healed of every sickness. One is just as easy as the other. In God's eyes, it's already a provision. It's already provided. By whose stripes you were healed. The blood has been shed, and you can receive forgiveness and cleansing every time of everything. Come to the Lord. 1 John 1:9 says, if you confess your sin, he's faithful and just to forgive you and to cleanse you. Well, that's every time. That's every time. That's every time. Then if that's true, and it is, Jesus asked the question, which is easier? Which is easier? To say your sins are forgiven or to say rise and walk? Which one's easier? Your sins are forgiven or rise and walk? Which one's easier? Your sins are forgiven or be healed of cancer? Which one's easier? Your sins are forgiven or your eyesight be restored? Which one's easier? Your sins are forgiven and cleansed, and your hearing is now restored. Which one's easier? Your sins are forgiven and cleansed, and the tumor is now cursed in Jesus' name and has to dissolve and disappear. Which one's easier? They're the same. The problem is on our end. Wrong teaching, wrong thinking, wrong believing. But in God's eyes, it's already provided. He went to the cross. I don't need to get him to go to the cross again. Lord, save Uncle Frank. Oh, we're just pleading. God, please save him. What's Jesus going to do? Go to the cross again for Uncle Frank? Uncle Frank needs to hear. Uncle Frank needs to believe. Pray that the laborers would go into the harvest. Pray ye therefore that the Lord of the harvest would send laborers. They need to hear and then open their hearts to believe and to receive. They need to hear. They need to hear. And then God opened their hearts to believe and to receive, because you've already provided it. And healing is just the same. One is no easier than the other. They have both been made provision for. Forgiveness and cleansing of sin has been provided by the precious blood of Jesus. And healing for our bodies has already been provided by the precious redemptive work of the Lord Jesus Christ, by whose stripes we were healed. Himself took our infirmities and bore our sicknesses. He washed away my sin with his own precious blood. And he brought healing to my body by the stripes laid upon his back and the redemptive work of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's already been done. Can somebody say amen? In 2 Peter, in chapter 1. 2 Peter, chapter 1. And verse 3. According as his divine power hath given. I want to call to your attention again, this is past tense. It's already been done. According as his divine power hath given, has already given unto us all things. Everybody say all. Does that include your thing? All means all. All things that pertain unto life and godliness. Jesus said, the thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I've come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. He came to counter what the devil has done, to reverse it and to redeem us from it. The devil came and brought death and the consequences of death, spiritual death. Jesus came to reverse that and to redeem us from that. Well, if he comes to steal, kill, and to destroy, Jesus came that he might have life and have it more abundantly. That's not just the joy of the Lord in my heart. That's in my circumstances. He said, I came that you might have peace, not as the world gives, but as I give. And he said in John chapter 16, he said, whatever you ask the Father in my name, he'll give it you. Hitherto, or up until now, you've not asked this way. You've not asked in my name. Then he said in John 16, ask and you'll receive that your joy may be full. Well, your heavenly Father knows that you have need of all of these things. The Gentiles are seeking things. Your Father knows you need these things. But he said to ask. He knows the things that you have need of before you ask. That's what he said. But ask and you receive that your joy may be full. So it's not just the joy of the Lord in my heart and the new birth and the presence of God in my spirit. But it's also he wants to get involved with my life. And give me life more abundantly. The joy of the Lord is my strength, and count it all joy. I mean, when I'm in adversity and pressure of life, I know how to count it all joy. But when I'm the trying of my faith puts patience to work. And there in James chapter 1, it says, when you're perfect and entire, you won't want anything because it produced results. It affects the physical realm, is what I'm saying. It's not just a spiritual blessing that's just in the spirit realm. It comes over into the natural realm. And he's already given us all things that pertain unto life and godliness. And that also pertains to the natural life. That's what I'm wanting you to see. That we're not of the world, but we're in the world. And your Father knows that you have need of these things. He wants you to have the things because he said, the Gentiles are seeking things. Your Father knows you need these things. But you seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness and these things. What are the things? Well, what are you going to eat? What are you going to drink? What are you going to put on? Is that right? Those are the things that he said would be added. So it's also in the natural realm. That's what I'm wanting to get across to you. It's also in the natural realm where he's my shepherd and I shall not want. He supplies all of my need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Well, then he's blessed me with all spiritual blessings. And his divine power has already given me everything that pertains to life and godliness. Well, that includes the natural life. It involves the physical realm. So he's already given unto us everything that pertains to life and godliness. Notice in verse 3 how it comes. Does it come by praying? Does it come by begging and pleading? Hoping to God one day, if he'll see fit to do something, I'm just trusting God one day he will. No, it doesn't say that. It says it comes through the knowledge. It comes through knowledge. That's why people need to hear what God's already done. People need to hear about it. They need to hear about what God's already done. Instead of asking him to do what he's already done, hear about it and then believe it and receive it. He's already done it. He's already provided it. Now hear about it. So how does this come? His divine power has already given it, by whose stripes ye were healed. The blood has been shed. He supplies all of our need according to his riches in glory. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, the things that are added. He's already done it. People are so busy praying for God to do what his word declares and expresses he's already done. But when we hear about it, we can receive it. It's an inheritance. Once you hear about what's been given to you in the inheritance, you just receive it. You sometimes have to drive and go to the office and sign the paper and receive it. It's already been provided, but you have to receive the ownership. Well, Jesus has already obtained some things, an inheritance. I'm an heir of God, and a joint heir with Jesus Christ. And the paper's been signed with his own precious blood. And now whatever I ask in the name of Jesus is given to me. I receive it and I thank him for it. It's already given, but it comes through knowledge. Everybody say through knowledge. He's given everything that could possibly pertain to life and godliness, but it comes through the knowledge of him that's called us to glory and virtue. Now I love verse 4. This is shouting ground. Whereby? Or this is the way. Whereby? By this means. By this way. Whereby? This is the very way that these things come. Whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises. I love that. I just love that. He didn't say promises. He didn't simply say precious promises. He didn't say great. He said exceeding great and precious promises, whereby means they come this way too. Through the knowledge of him that's called us to glory and virtue, and the same way, through this same knowledge, come these exceeding great and precious promises. I hear about them. Once you hear about it, you receive it. You believe it, receive it, and act like it. Act like it's true. Somebody said faith is just taking God at his word and acting like it. Just go ahead and act like it's true. Read it, believe it, receive it, and act like it's true. Whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these, by what? The exceeding great and precious promises. That by these, by what? The exceeding great and precious promises that have already been given. He's already blessed us with all spiritual blessings. Well, it's already been given us everything that pertains to life and godliness. It's already been given, already been given, already been given, already been given. It's already been given. It's already been given. I don't need to ask him for something he's already given me. I need to thank him for it. Once I see it and believe it, I need to receive it and thank him for it. He's already given it. These exceeding great and precious promises, by these, I'm a partaker of the divine nature. I mean, I start acting like my father. Divine nature. I've had more than one person say to me, well, that's just his nature. Referring to somebody else and how they're acting. Well, that's just his nature. On occasion, I'll say it out loud, what I'm almost always thinking in my mind. I'll say it out loud. Well, they need to get saved. And, well, he's a Christian. Sometimes you say it out loud. Oh, he's a Christian. Well, he needs to act like it then. He needs to be a partaker of the divine nature. Children of the devil act like the devil. Children of God should act like God. In fact, Ephesians chapter 5 says we're to be followers. Imitators. That word a follower means imitator of God as dear children. Ephesians 5:1, be ye therefore followers of God as dear children. The word follower there means imitator. That is, you're a child of God. Act like God. Act like your father. natural children, little 5-year-old and 6-year-old and 7-year-old, they want to act like their parents. That little 5-year-old boy wants to act like his father. The 5-year-old girl, the little girl, she wants to put on mama's shoes and mama's hat and mama's makeup. And is that right? Well, we're to act like God as dear children, be an imitator of God as dear children. I can when I realize I have his nature. Do you know why kittens meow? Because cats do. Kittens meow because cats do. You know why puppies bark? Because dogs do. It's their nature. They take on the nature. Do you know why guppies swim? Because fish do. It's their nature. Well, we have the nature of God, a divine nature. When you walk in the light, when you walk in the spirit, you don't fulfill the lust of the flesh. Because you have a new nature on the inside of you. People say, well, that just runs in his family. Well, he needs to get saved, get in a new family. They'll medically, try to explain things. Well, that just runs in the family. Well, I'm in a new family. I've got a new father. I've got a new nature. And let me tell you what runs in my family. Healing runs in my family. Healing and health and life and strength and energy. That's what runs in my family. And whatever runs in the natural family, the spiritual family overrides that. And I can have something to say about that. It stops right here. Maybe my grandfather and my father and maybe all, in the family tree, they have these conditions. But it stops here. Because I'm in a new family. I've got a new father. I've got new blood. I've got new life. I've got divine life. I've got a divine nature. By whose stripes I was healed. He took my infirmities and bore my sicknesses. He bore the curse. He became the curse. And I have life. I don't have to resist the curse. I received Jesus who bore the curse. Can somebody say amen? Well, it's how I partake of the divine nature is when I know these exceeding great and precious promises. I just want to walk in the light of it. Act like my father. This is what I see in the word of God. My father's like, I want to walk this way too. I want to talk this way too. I'm going to do this too because I'm a partaker of the divine nature. I've escaped. Having escaped, that's past tense. These things are past tense. I have escaped the corruption that's in the world through lust, and that is spiritual death. The corruption that's in the world through lust is spiritual death. I've escaped that. I've escaped that. I have the spirit of life. I have the nature of life. The law of the spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. I have a new nature. I have a divine nature. I have God's nature. I'm an heir of God and a joint heir with Jesus Christ. And I learn about it by the exceeding great and precious promises. It comes through the knowledge of him that's called us to glory and virtue. He's already given us all things that pertain unto life and godliness. It's past tense. It's already done. I learn about it. I receive the knowledge of these exceeding great and precious promises. I believe it. I receive it. And I thank God for it. Can somebody say amen? Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Said out loud, I have the promises now. I have his nature now. A divine nature. Raise your hand and thank him for it. Hallelujah. Father, thank you for the divine nature in me now. Thank you for exceeding great and precious promises. I want to increase in knowledge. The knowledge of you by your word. By your spirit and walk in the light and receive. And I thank you for it. I thank you for it. Raise your other hand. Just praise him for it.